The first time yesterday, as I spent some hours in study, I would get up from time to time and go to the window. And I noticed the birds were searching and they were looking. And so I went to my bird seed, and for the first time, I started feeding them yesterday. And two little sparrows came, and they stayed down on the floor of the porch. And I was trying to signify to them that I left the seed up on the rail. And I found myself talking to them. I said, "You silly little sparrows, it's all up on the rail, not down on the deck of the porch." And then I considered for a moment, how can I get them to understand that it's down on the lower level and not up on the railing? I said, if I had the power, if I could go against gravity, I would just string them a trail of bird seed from down there on the flooring of the deck all the way up to the rail. But I can't defy gravity. There's no way I could string it out and leave them a trail. I thought about if I could just put it on different levels of the railing of the porch, but it wouldn't stick there. And I just couldn't get it through to them that the only thing you had to do was move up just a little bit higher, and right there's everything that you need. And dear friend, if I could just get it through to everyone here today, if we'd just move up a little bit higher. And the only thing that we have to do to move up a little bit higher is to take Jesus at His word, hold on to His promises. He's reaching down that nail-scarred hand to us. And He's the one that is able to elevate us. And so when we couldn't get to Him, when we didn't understand, when we didn't realize where the blessings were, Jesus came down to us. And in John 1:14, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And one of my favorite verses of Scripture in the entirety of the New Testament is found over in 1 Timothy chapter 3 at verse 16. You can look at it a little bit later on. And listen to what Paul says to Timothy, 1 Timothy 3, 16. He begins and says, "Without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness." You can debate it all you want to debate it. You can hash it back and forth. But without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness, that God was manifested in the flesh, that He was justified in the Spirit, that He was seen of angels, that He was preached unto the Gentiles, He was believed on in the world, and then He was received up into glory. And in that one verse of Scripture, you have the encapsulation of the gospel message without controversy. Great is the mystery of godliness, that God was manifested in the flesh, justified in the Spirit. He's the holy, sinless Lamb of God. And then listen, He was seen of angels, and that is referring to prophets. They saw that He was coming, and they verified that somebody's on their way. He was seen of angels, those messengers of God. He was preached unto Gentiles, believed on in the world. He's alive. He's arisen. He's the conqueror of death, hell, and the grave. And then the ascension, He was received up into glory. 1 Timothy 3 at verse 16. And so He came down to fulfill His promises. And to consider today your church membership, of how privileged we are. Now, last night I was continuing to study, and I went out and made a visit, and I came back in, and I would that I hadn't have, but I got interested in a football game. I got interested in that Penn State and Wisconsin game. And Penn State pulled it out. I was rooting for them. That school has been under such scrutiny, and it was never the players' fault. They were innocent in everything that transpired at Penn State, but they were penalized for it, and that happens so many times. The coach does the wrong, he moves on to another school, and the university and the kids that are playing, they're the ones that get in trouble. You say, "Preacher, what in the world?" I didn't know, I won't even mention their name, that I was coming to hear a sports broadcaster, but I watched it, and Penn State won. And I was pulling for him because I like Coach Franklin. He used to coach at Vanderbilt. I like Vanderbilt because down there they saved my son's life. And so I've got connections just all over the place that way. But it seems like even after beating, sorry, Jesse, Ohio State, that Penn State's not going to be in the Final Four, that they didn't do enough, and they call it their total body of work. And so with their total body of work, they're not going to be playing for a national championship. We'll know a little bit more about it this afternoon. Aren't you glad today that Jesus did not judge you by your defeats or your victories? Aren't you thankful that He did not take your total body of work for the whole season of your life and said, well, I think they are qualified. Let me go back again to those verses I used a few weeks ago, Colossians 1 and 12, giving thanks unto the Father who hath made us meet to be partakers, fit and qualified to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who had delivered us from the power of darkness, translated us into the kingdom of His dear Son, in whom we have redemption through His blood, even the forgiveness of sin. And I didn't earn it. I didn't deserve it. I wasn't qualified, but the promise keeper came down to all of us promise breakers. And today we've got the promise, and I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I got into the church when I was 6 years old. I accepted Jesus as my Lord, my Savior. I followed Him through the door to the church, baptism, and I'm a member of the church. And the more I learn from the Word of God, I see how privileged I am. And you say, well, preacher, I'm a member of this, or I'm a member of that, and I'm a member of the Hall of Fame and in basketball or football. Dear friend, there is no greater privilege than being a member of the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ. I love that old song that we used to sing. I'm in this church, this glorious church. Brother Jackson, he could roll it out there. He said, I didn't join, I was born, I've had a new birth. And then he goes on to say, and some glorious day, we're going to sail away. I'm in His church. And today, what I know, we take it for granted. I know people just drop in, stop in when it's convenient. But dear friend, there is nothing that compares on this earth. And there will never be anything that will compare in heaven to the blood-bought, redeemed church of the Lord Jesus Christ. So when Jesus came down to Bethlehem, you have to see He had a purpose in mind. He had the purpose in mind that He's going to be the head of the body, the church, and it's referred to as the body of Christ. And so over there in Colossians 1 and 18, the Bible says, and He is the head of the body, the church, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things He might have the preeminence. And He not only came down to be the head of the body, the church, He came down to purchase Him a bride. And again, the church, Ephesians 5 and 25, and husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church. And look what He did. He gave Himself for it. And then He came down to be the foundation of the building. And again, I'm talking about the church. In Ephesians 2 and 20, He says, the church, He says, we are built upon the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, and Jesus Christ Himself being the cornerstone, of whom the whole building is fitly framed together. What a blessing. I'm talking about the body, the bride, and the building in this metaphoric language of the Lord Jesus Christ. And some people, they can just kind of live without the church. And they can pass the church by like a freight train passing by a hobo. But dear friend, I understand the church. I understand that it's the living organism, the body of Christ, the mystical body of Christ here upon the earth. I understand that we're not all that we should be, but thank God I'm not what I used to be, and I praise His holy name that I'm not what I'm going to be, because He's going to transform this bride. I've watched it time after time on wedding rehearsal night. I'll look over at the poor little old bridegroom and I'll say, "Sweetheart, do you realize there's no hope here? I hope she can cook, hope she can sing, but she's not too attractive." You'd say, "Preacher, that's pretty plain." Well, I'm just telling you the truth. And so look around today at this church. And I'm telling you, like that homely bride, as we used to say around here in the mountains, only way you could get the dogs to play with them is tie a pork chop around their neck, brother. I'm talking about homely. But the next night at the wedding, that little girl standing here, and of course she may have become a bridezilla, and she's stressed out and been crying, and one mother-in-law wants this, another mother-in-law wants that. But on wedding night, and she stands in that door, and I look up and I say, "Is that her? Did he get another one? Did he swap out? Did he take her down to the car lot and said, 'This model's old and dinged up, and I want to trade it in for a newer, better looking model?'" And she comes down that aisle, and I see a metamorphosis. I see a transformation from that little haggly thing that was standing here at the wedding rehearsal. And here she comes arrayed. You see, we forget about that. He's not done with us. Being confident of this very thing, that he that had begun a good work in you, he's going to perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Now let me go back to verse 18 of Matthew chapter 16. And he said, "I say also unto thee that thou art Peter," and the Greek word there for Peter is Petros, and it means a little pebble. "But I am Petra, I am the large rock, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." Knowing what Peter was going to do yonder in the shadow of the cross, how that he's going to deny him three times, how that he's going to curse and say, "I never knew him," there is no possibility after all that God had done. It's totally illogical to think it for a moment that after all that God did in planning salvation, and not only salvation, his church, God is the architect of it, the author and the finisher of our faith, that he would allow the cornerstone, the foundation of the church, to be Simon Peter. There's only one qualified, only one with the supremacy and the authority to be the chief cornerstone of the church, and that's Jesus. Now, this New Testament fulfillment is rooted back in an Old Testament prophecy. And you find it all the way back in the 118th Psalms, and it's found in verses 23 and 24. And listen to what he says. "The stone that the builders refused has become the head of the corner. This is the Lord's doing, and it's marvelous in our eyes." And when you think about Jesus coming to his own, and his own received him not, but to as many as did receive him, to them he gave the power to become the sons of God, to as many as believed upon his name, and how that they reject him, rejected it. Is not this the son of Joseph and Mary? And they were rejecting the head of the corner. But thank God, I've got eyes to see him. I recognize him today. He is the foundation of every blessing that we know in our lives. But let me show you three passages of Scripture very quickly. And they're prominent in the Bible. And so we find this verse from the 118 Psalms, 22 through 24. It's repeated over and over again. Jesus even referred to it in the New Testament over in Matthew 21. But turn with me to Isaiah. And I want you to notice, if you would, the 28th chapter of the book of Isaiah. And the best way to find Isaiah, go right to the middle of your Bible, Psalms, and begin to turn to the right. Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, the Song of Solomon, and then you come to the prophet Isaiah. And Isaiah, he has a picture of the Savior. He has a picture of what it's going to be like in utopia, the millennial reign of Christ on earth. And then he has a picture of the church. And so listen to what he says in verse 16. There's a word that I want you to underline. And he has this very same view that David had in the 118 Psalms. "Therefore, thus saith the Lord God, behold, I lay in Zion for a foundation, a stone." Now listen to how he refers to him. "A tried stone, a precious cornerstone." Listen to what else he says. A sure foundation. Oh, this is going to be important in a moment. Stay with me now. And he that believeth on him, and it's going to be a little bit different where this is requoted, shall not make haste. And that word haste, it means to hurry away. I tell you, with all that is within me today, and knowing what God has done with me as a pastor for 41 years now, I'm not in any hurry to move away to any new ideology. There's nothing out there that I read philosophically that draws my attention. There's no new quotes by any elite academician that gets my attention and causes me to wander away just a little bit. And I heard him this week, Stephen Hawking, and he's just too unsure to die. He's been suffering from ALS, Lou Gehrig's. They think he's the most brilliant mind in the world today. But yet he believes in aliens, and he believes they probably formed the earth, and he's atheistic, and people are hanging on every word that he says. And you know, he has to talk to a computer, and people are so interested in his quotes. And then he said, 2017 is going to be the most dangerous year that the planet has ever known. Well, I didn't need this academician, this so-called elite intellectual. I know about perilous times, don't you? And Jesus said, this know also, that in the last days, perilous times shall come. And so today, I'm on the rock-solid foundation of Jesus. And here's what I'm trying to say. They will not make haste. I don't know of anything that's any more satisfying. You say, well, preacher, the problem with you, you were raised in a pastor's home, and now you've been preaching all these years, and you've never experienced anything else. Well, that's a testimony within itself. He's so satisfying, I've never tried it. And I say, hallelujah. I say, glory to his high and holy name. I praise him today that not only is he the seeker of my soul, and he came looking for me when I wasn't looking for him, but he's also the satisfier of my soul, and he continues to lead me and make me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside of the still waters. He restores my soul, and I've never found anything any better than the rock solid foundation of Jesus, and I believe I'll just stay right where I've been planted, and all the building now is fitly framed together. Now, some of you are not convinced, and here's what you might have to do. You might have to go away a little while and make a little haste and hurry off the foundation. Can you imagine now this beautiful rock that we have in our auditorium? And Boyd and Hunter laid most of this around the baptistry here. Can you imagine one of these stones deciding, I don't believe I'll stay there any longer. I'm not satisfied just being here, just an old rock, and I was placed in this beautiful edifice, this sanctuary, and I'm helping to hold the water in the baptistry so they can continue to baptize. But I believe I'll jump down from here. And I believe I'll fit in another wall somewhere. I believe I'll go somewhere and see if I can find something better than what's being offered in the church of the living Lord. Well, you old stupid rock, do you know that you were found out there in the discard pile? Do you know that you were found out there in the heap? Do you know that you were out there with what had been refused and rejected, and there was no possibility of you ever fitting in anywhere? Dear friend, I'm telling you, I'm thankful that he picked me up out of the reject pile. And that's where he found you, rejected and alone and disappointed and despondent. And he began to work on you and to fit you into the building of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we're built upon the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, and Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, and all the building fitly framed together. Go on. Go on. Go on. Make haste. See how that ends up. See how that works out for you. Find an excuse. Justify yourself. I got my feelings hurt at church, and I just don't think I fit in any longer. I tried to fit in, Mr. and Mrs. Standoffish, never speak to anybody, never any evidence of the fruit of the Spirit, I had a little letter this week, and an elderly lady wrote to me and said, "My good friend don't like you. Here's the reason she don't like you, because you're always picking on the Baptist." And so I wrote a note to her, and I said, "Tell her I've been a Baptist all of these years, and if anybody has any right to find fault and criticize, it's me. And Baptists can be cantankerous. Am I telling the truth? I've got the fruit of the Spirit. Well, I can smell it over here. It's those black bananas that need to be thrown out. You can't even make a pudding out of those, brother. It's that old orange that's shriveled up. It's that old apple that's dark all over. I don't even think we could call one good bite out of it." Oh, boy, it got quiet all of a sudden. I'm talking about rotten fruit of the Spirit. And you're contrary, and it's your way. And listen to what he says in the close of the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians 5 at verse 26. "And let us not be desirous of vainglory." And there's some people who want to be recognized. Oh, I like what old Lester Roloff used to say. He said, if you want to serve God, he said, bless God, serve him. But if you're expecting me to put your name on the end of the pew or dedicate a stained glass window to you, he said, you're barking up the wrong tree. If you're going to serve him, serve him. And don't serve him to be seen. Serve him because you love him. Serve him because he's given everything to you. Serve him because your heart's set upon him. Serve him because he's been good to you. Serve him because there's going to be a great day in the future. I like that, don't you? Why don't we just do what we're doing for him and do it all for his glory? Because he's the one that is worthy of the glory. Let's look at another time that this is used in the scripture. I want you to turn with me over to Romans chapter 9. And the best way to find Romans is go to the first book of the New Testament, which is Matthew. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans chapter 9. This is a great salvation chapter, and Paul really outlines in Romans 9 how to be saved. But listen to what he says in verse 33. He said, this is the problem with the Jewish people. Look at the close now of the 32nd verse. He calls Jesus a stumbling stone. And a lot of people, they still stumble at just the mention of the name of Jesus. As it is written, 118, 22, 23, and 24. And then again, Isaiah 28 at verse 16. As it is written, behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone, a rock of offense. And whosoever believeth on him, watch this now, shall not be ashamed. Now, back there in Isaiah, it said, shall not make haste, won't be easily moved, and won't hurry off. They're going to stay with it. And now he says, they shall not be ashamed. Now, everybody in this room, everybody watching by television right now, there are a lot of things in our lives that we have to be ashamed of. And I'm ashamed that I've not done more for the Lord. And I'm ashamed that I've not prayed more. And I'm ashamed that I don't know more of the Scripture. I'm ashamed that I've not been a better soul winner. I'm ashamed that I've not loved the people of God like I really ought to love them. I'm ashamed that I've been insensitive to the leadership of the Holy Spirit. A lot of things. And we can go all the way back in our past. And we can go back to high school days or college days. And we can all see those things that we ought to be ashamed of. But I got good news. When it comes to the rock solid foundation of the church, I don't find anything whatsoever to be ashamed of. I'm not ashamed of how that he was born in a virgin, wrapped in swaddling clothes, laid in a manger. I'm not ashamed of how that he grew up in a carpenter shop and then is showing to Israel when he was 30 years old. I'm not ashamed of how that he was baptized by his cousin John the Baptist, and the voice came from heaven, from the Father, "This is my beloved Son, and whom I'm well pleased." I'm not ashamed of how that he went to the wedding feast at Cana, Galilee, and turned the water into wine. I'm not ashamed that he picked up the scroll of the book of Isaiah, Isaiah 61, when he read in his hometown synagogue, and he said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor and to bind up the brokenhearted." I'm not ashamed that demons were no match for him. I'm not ashamed that he never met a disease that he could not cure. I'm not ashamed that he could go to the bow of the boat, stretch forth his hand and say, peace be still. And the winds and waves would lay down like a big collie dog at the feet of its master. I'm not ashamed of how that he traveled on to Jerusalem and he set his face like a flint. I'm not ashamed of how they mocked him and ridiculed him and spit upon him and crowned him with a crown of thorns and he took the scourging across his back. I'm not ashamed of how that they stripped him of his garments and plaited a crown of thorns and placed it upon his head. I'm not ashamed that he bore the old rugged cross out to Calvary and he said, no man takes my life. I got the power to lay it down. I got the power to take it up again. I'm not ashamed of how that he mounted the old rugged cross and he rode it for 6 long hours. I'm not ashamed of his 7 sayings. Father, forgive them. They don't know what they do. Into your hands I commend my spirit. It is finished. Today you'll be with me in paradise. I find nothing there to be ashamed of. And I'm certainly not ashamed today that on the 3rd morning, according to his holiness, according to his sinlessness, according to his total perfection, God raised him up with a mighty hand from the dead, alive forevermore, has the keys to death, hell, and the grave. I'm not ashamed. With many infallible proofs, he showed himself alive after his passion. I'm not ashamed that he went out to the mount called Olivet and he ascended back to the Father, and 2 men appeared in white apparel and said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye here gazing into the heaven? This same Jesus that you've seen taken up will come again in like manner, even as you've seen him go. I find nothing in the foundation of the church to ever, 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 ever to be ashamed of. Nothing in him to be ashamed of.